Yeah, but we can quickly go through that.
Okay. Fine, so course curriculum and all, anyway, you'll have it, so I'm not going to the what are we teaching and all. Now, yeah, going straight away into, like, you must be aware, like, big data is not just about amount of data, it's all about how we process that amount of data. So it's mostly about transactional as well as interactional data. When we say transactional data, it's about relational data which is flowing from our legacy sources, and interaction data is all about like unstructured format of data what we have. So since you know basic of big data, so I'll ask you one question out here, like, has big data evolved to replace relational database, or is it just an addition to a relational database?
No, I think it's addition to it. It can replace the relation because it's not transitional, right? So,
right. So it's just that we add on to the existing relational databases so as to get more insight into the business which we have, right? So, so this is about transaction and interactional data, and then quickly going into, these are three V's which we call in big data. So why this is theoretical concepts are important, because if you're applying to go out for cloud data certification or something, these theoretical aspects come in handy, because there are multiple choice questions where these theoretical things are asked. So, like, what are the three V's? It's variety. Like, we can big data, we can just like any ETL tool, we have different sources like Oracle, Siebel. Like in Informatica, we can connect to different sources like Oracle, Siebel, Teradata, SQL Server, and get our job onto a common staging layer, and from there we can dump it to our final target tables in EDW somewhere. So similarly, in big data also, we can manage different types of data, and what separates it from the rest is that the speed at which these different variety of data and the volume, because it can handle huge amount of data, and it can handle it terribly fast. So this is what we mean when we say three V's of big data: variety, velocity, and volume. So going further, this is where Hadoop lies in the entire enterprise data lifecycle. Like, once we generate or get data from different sources, and then we bring it onto a like the transformation layer where we capture and store the data, and then there are different BI tools which take input from Hadoop as well as from different ETL tools and present our data. Now,
so when you say this BI tools, is like, it can be like business observer and any other tools like ClickView and all those things, right? It's specific to Hadoop.
Yeah, business objects, ClickView, or it can be Tableau, Cognos, but but one addition to it is that the legacy tools like Business Object, Cognos, which are quite established in the market, recently they came up with some plugins which will connect with Hadoop, but there are tools like Tableau and Spotfire who are more compatible with Hadoop, and they are becoming more like popular. When we are using Hadoop as our integration layer, it's Tableau and Spotfire, these tools are becoming more prevalent among the organizations. So business objects and Cognos are there, but it's Tableau, Spotfire, these couple of tools are gaining more prominence rather than Vue and Cognos.
Okay.
Yeah. Now, this is like, as we know, like Hadoop is divided into two parts. One is a processing unit, which will be taken care by, I'm not sure, because as you told, you have gone through, so I'm just quickly going through. If you need some
to be holding, if I think I need more information, I'll ask you,
So we know, like, there are two parts. One is a processing part, and the other one is, so any, so how many people we have in over? Organization, if you can go on mute, and if you have any questions, you can unmute and ask, that will be better, actually. I'm getting a lot of background.
Okay, I'll do it.
Started, yeah.
let me put in the chat.
So there are two parts to Hadoop or any other data technology involving data warehousing concepts and all. Like one will be how do you store your data, and the other will be how to go ahead and process the data. Yeah, it's better now. So one is about how you go ahead and store your data, and the other one is how you process that data. So for storage, we have something called like HDFS. It's a distributed file system which tells us how we go ahead and store data in a database, and to process that data, which is there into Hadoop layer, we have something called as a MapReduce, which will process your data. So MapReduce programs are something which are written in Java, as you know. But to, as you said, like you are not proficient enough in Java, but you can manage. Similarly, there are multiple other folks who say that they are not comfortable working completely on Java. So to hide the complexity of writing MapReduce programs, there are multiple other clients on top of MapReduce program which helps us to do tasks in a simple way. Like you might have heard about Pig, Hive, HBase, and there are other clients like Scoop, Uzi, Impala. All these clients, they help us to do our task in a very simple way, rather than going into the complexity of writing complex Java programs or Python programs or Perl script. Because apart from writing MapReduce in Java, we can write it in Python, or we can write it down in Perl scripts. So these are the different programming languages which can be used to write MapReduce program. But initially, when Hadoop came into existence, it was these MapReduce programs which were used to process data onto a HDFS layer. But slowly things got simpler, and we had different tools like Pig, Hive, HBase, and the other clients to take care of that complexity. So we'll discuss about Pig, Hive, and the other stuff later. Now let's concentrate mostly on to HDFS. So how do we store data, and then how do we work in a HDFS environment? So that I'll show in the cloud era setup. But before that, let's talk about HDFS a bit. So yeah, this is something you must be knowing, like the difference between relational database and Hadoop. So relational databases uses extensive, like these servers would be costly to manage, because if you require a space of, let's say, generally in a relational legacy system, what would happen? Like if you require, if you want to set up an EDW, you'll purchase a server which would be, let's say, 200 GB in size, but you, at the present moment, you just require 20 GB of information to be stored. So the additional 180 GB of information, like storage capacity, you unnecessarily maintain. So to get rid of that, in Hadoop, we have different commodity servers in place, and you can scale up. You can add on to those commodity servers as and when required. So these are a few differences you can just quickly go through. Like these are expensive, dedicated hardware required in relational DB, but in Hadoop, we use less expensive commodity servers. Similarly, these are built for, like, they are extremely scalable, because you can add on as and when required. And then there are other things like it supports only model and structured data, and Hadoop stored supports both type of data and all. So this is pretty much okay. Now, yeah, these are the core components, HDFS and MapReduce. HDFS is all about how we store our data, and MapReduce is about how we process our data. Now, this is something important about Hadoop, distributed file system. So let me get into Excel. So you have something called as a node. Then we have something called as a cluster on top of a node, right? So you have a node. Then a combination of nodes. Now, suppose node is just your terminal. So this particular VMware terminal is one node. Similarly, if you are logged on to a particular terminal, that is one node. So we have different nodes, and then collection of these nodes is called as a cluster. Right? So you have nodes, and the collection of all these nodes is called as a cluster. So SDFS is somewhat this entire block. Okay, so let me tell that more elaborately. So it is Hadoop distributed file system is responsible for storing data on a cluster. So this is a cluster. How the data will be divided among different nodes, how will it be stored, will be taken care by the Hadoop distributed file system. And generally, data in a Hadoop cluster is stored in the form of blocks on different nodes. So assume that you have a 100 MB file to be stored. So we can have data split across different nodes, probably in block size of, let's say, 40 MB here, 40 here, and then 20 here. So somewhat like this, data will be split across different nodes based upon the algorithm which Hadoop follows internally. Now, but the default block size is 64 MB, which is inbuilt into the Hadoop administration. So if you want to change the default size of any block which is stored in HDFS environment, we can certainly do that, but that is done by the admin guys who can change the configuration and make it to some other like 128 MB or the multiples of 64 MB. It can be your blocks can be, block size can be increased or decreased based upon the your requirement, but the default block size is 64 MB. And that's what is written here. The data is split into multiple blocks, and this will be stored across different multiple nodes in the cluster. And each block is by default of size 64 MB. And there's something else which Hadoop does is to provide fault tolerance. So assume that you have your data is stored in different nodes, and what if this particular node goes down? So in order to maintain availability of data uninterruptedly, you need to have these information stored in different, you need to have a backup of this table as well, right? Backup of the data stored in this node as well. So to provide fault tolerance or to provide backup mechanism, recovery mechanism, each block of data is replicated size. So suppose this is a block one of data, the same block will be present here as well as it will be present here. Present here and it will be present here. So this ensures that you have a fault tolerance mechanism in place, and even if this particular node goes down, you have a other node which can take care of the data. Okay, so this is what we have when we tell that each block is replicated three times. So the default is that each tolerance mechanism as per client requirement, then we can increase the replication factor. But generally, if we have each block of data on a Hadoop cluster replicated thrice, and replicas are stored on different nodes. That's what I demonstrated here. Like if suppose one block of data is here, the other two replicas will be obviously on stored in different nodes, right? Just to provide more fault tolerant mechanism. And then the reason being that this ensures both reliability and availability. Availability, like if a particular node goes down, you have the other nodes from where you can fetch in data, and availability because the data will be available all the time for you. Now, this is how things happen in a, like as you told that you are aware of data node, name node. So just giving a brief introduction about what is, how we can, I'll not go into the analogy because this is what guys require if they are new to the name node and data node. Since you have the knowledge, I'll just talk about how, what are the different features of a name node, data node, what is a job tracker, task tracker. I'll just quickly go through that. So generally in the Hadoop distributed file system, so suppose a task comes in. A task comes in to us that, okay, we have provided you with a, let's say, a PDF file, and the requirement is to the beginner's requirement in Hadoop programming, like you're given a PDF file and you need to find the occurrence of each word in that file. That is your job. So as soon as this particular job is submitted by the client, it goes to a name node, because name node is something which, so yeah, before talking about name, just giving you a small analogy, so because then I can correlate and make you understand what are this name node, data node. So just take an analogy of a manager and a team. So you have a team of, let's say, 6 developers, and they are interacting among each other. So they'll be knowing what each team member is doing based upon, like, they'll be interacting with each other, and they'll have a single point of control, which is a manager, who will be knowing who all resources are available and will be allocating tasks accordingly based upon their availability. And in case of if a manager is absent, you have an assistant manager who can take care of the daily deliverables, and he'll be informed by the manager on a daily basis as to what are the things happening in the team, what are the proceedings of the team. So if we can relate this particular analogy to Hadoop cluster, what happens, like, you'll have a name node which takes care of the data nodes in Hadoop cluster, Hadoop distributed file system. So a name node will have multiple data nodes associated with them, and each data node will interact with themselves, knowing each other's availability, and they will interact in turn with name node as well. So we have a central name node, and then there are multiple data nodes. A name node will have something called as a job tracker, where all the details of the job which have been assigned by the client will be mentioned, and then based upon their availability, suppose the task is to split up a PDF, to get the number of occurrences of each word in a PDF file. So we can split it into 3-4 ways. Like, let's say the file size is 20 MB, it will give, we want to separate it in, let's say, 4 parts and give 5 MB to be processed upon by different nodes. So before we go ahead and distribute the task, we need to know whether the data nodes are available or not, whether they are alive, or like whether they are in working condition, first thing. Secondly, if they are in working condition, are they doing some other task or not? So once the name node gets the information that, okay, these set of data nodes are available for our task, then what happens, like, from the job tracker, entries are made into the task tracker. Okay, these are just the logical concepts, like, from a name node. So name node will be controlling the data nodes. Name node will have a job tracker, which in turn will, like, interact with the task tracker, assign them the task, and then the task will be completed by this data node, passed on back to the name node, which will in turn go and demonstrate on the terminal, or like the Hadoop terminal which we have. So this is how the flow of data happens, and in case of a failure, you have a secondary name node. Now there is a question which is asked in cloud data certification exams, like, suppose if a name, so we have, like, suppose if a data node fails, so if a data node fails, you can retrieve your data from some other data node. Why? Because your data is replicated across multiple nodes. That is first thing. Okay, now suppose if your name node fails, so if your name node fails, what happens? You have a secondary name node to fall upon, from where you can make the things run smoothly. Now the question which is asked in cloud data certification is that, what if your secondary name node fails? Then in that case, what will happen? So the answer is, if your secondary name node fails in your Hadoop cluster, then your processing will stop. There will be a blackout and nothing will be done. So we should ensure that our name node and our secondary name node are always up and running. So if your data node goes down, you have a failover mechanism. If your name node goes down, you have a secondary name node as a failover mechanism. But if your secondary name node goes down, then you don't have anything to fall back upon. Then there will be a blackout and the admin needs to be brought in to take, like, bring the things up. So this is about name node, data node, secondary name node, job tracker and task tracker. So when you submit a map reduce, it goes to the job tracker, as I said, and then job tracker like interacts with the name node to understand like which all data nodes are available to take up this task. So once name node identifies that, let's say data node 1 and data node 4 are available, then job tracker assigns them the task in the task tracker and the corresponding data nodes will do the job and give it back to the name node. So this is how we work. It's a logical representation of how things happen in a Hadoop cluster. Now, this is the theoretical stuff of MapReduce. I'll not be covering that. Now, getting into a couple of other features. So MapReduce and all I'll get into later. Now, giving you a feel of this info, like Hadoop tool. So we are talking about HDFS environment. So let's see how do we work on the HDFS environment. So I'm just opening the VMware machine. Okay. So, one moment. So, there are a set of files which I'll be sharing across later. This is the admin console. I'll just start from scratch so that you can get up. So this is Eclipse where we go ahead and write MapReduce programs. Now, this is a VMware setup and you have a Cloudera installed on this. Okay. So to work on this, this is a local environment on VMware, and to work on Hadoop environment, we need to go into the HDFS system, Hadoop Distributed File System. So how do we toggle between our local setup or local file system to a Hadoop file system? So let's learn about that. So this is my local system. Suppose I kept a file here. Let's say I just kept one empty file. This I already have. Suppose I have a new empty file here. There are some entries there, employee ID and salary. Mm-hmm. Let me just rename it. So this is one file which we have in a local environment. So to do any processing in Hadoop, we need to bring our files into a HDFS environment. So if you want to use the power of Hadoop, it can't be done on our local environment. We need to bring any file which you want to process, be it structured, unstructured, whatever you want to do. You need to bring your files into a HDFS environment, and then only different Hadoop techniques can be applied to mine upon that data or to analyze that data or to load it somewhere. So the first and the foremost goal of any Yep.
So are you saying Hadoop can only work on like files? Like if it's on database and all, we can't do it. We need to extract in a file and then work on it.
No, no. Hadoop distributed file system is just an environment. So okay, you can certainly plug into a database and we can work onto it.
Okay.
HDFS is just like a Unix box. HDFS is just a different environment.
Okay.
Yep. So now we'll, if you have a Cloudera setup, you can also just do, like if we have a write, just do a one second. Just we need to go to a terminal. So as you see the dollar prompt came in, so now we'll be working between local environment and the HDFS environment. So just to see where am I right now, for the working directory, I went to home training. Okay. So all the data or all the files which I have, it's on the this particular path, home and training path. So this is my local path. This is home and training. Assume in this training path, suppose I have this file, which is in my local environment, orders.txt. Now, to work in Hadoop, the command are almost like the Unix command, which we generally use in like Unix environments. To work in Hadoop also, the commands are almost similar. The only difference is that we need to prefix it with a Hadoop, 1 minute, Hadoop space FS. Okay, I'll go to Hadoop space FS later. Now, suppose in my local environment, if I want to go ahead and see the number of files available, how do we do? Just ls hyphen, or like just ls, and we get the details, right? These are the files present in my local setup. Now, if we want to, so this is what I'm viewing in my local environment. Now, if I want to view the files which are available in the HDFS environment, in Hadoop environment, the command is same ls, but this needs to be prefixed by a command called HADT, Hadoop space FS, and then you need to put a hyphen and then this command. So whenever we want to, so this command gives us a signal that we are now going to fire this particular command onto a Hadoop environment. So Hadoop space FS, which stands for file system, tells the compiler that now go ahead and fetch the information from a Hadoop system, not from the local system. So now you see. So we are trying to connect to HDFS environment, so it takes a bit of time. See. These are the files which are present in the Hadoop environment. So this is the difference between local setup. So just to see the content in my local environment, we just wrote a ls command. And if you want to see the same information, same, if I want to see the content of the file in the Hadoop environment, we just need to prefix a Hadoop space fs and then a hyphen ls. Like the commands remain the same, it's just that you need to prefix it with a Hadoop fs. Now assume that suppose we want to view the content of a particular file in a normal setup environment. What we do? Like ls forward slash, let's say home and training. What are the contents there? Okay. This is just real, right? So if you want to view the content of the same, like if a particular file in Hadoop environment, we just write it this way. Hadoop space fs hyphen ls forward slash user, there the root directory is user, and then I think it is training only. Generally, whenever we fire a command on Hadoop system, it takes a bit of time in the virtual machine. So see, these are the files which are present in a Hadoop environment. So when you need to toggle between local environment and Hadoop environment, just make sure that you type in Hadoop, this particular command, extra, like Hadoop space fn space hyphen and then the normal command. So this is what we typed here. This is what we are typing here, is just that extra Hadoop space fn and then the hyphen thing is coming up. So if you want to know what are the different options available in Hadoop file system, you can just simply type Hadoop space fs. We can get that information. See, these are different options available. So Hadoop file system. So it's just similar to the man command which we have in Unix. A man command will give you the details about a particular command. Similarly, if you want to see the content of a file or anything in Hadoop distributed file system, that you can do by using a Hadoop space fs command. So if suppose I want to see, I want to make a directory in Hadoop. Okay, assume we have something like a user training. This folder is in Hadoop, right? Because we fired in this command in Hadoop environment. So assume that we have, we need to create a particular directory in user training. So in this path, I need to create a directory with a name, let's say Hadoop underscore 0314. So how do we create that in Hadoop environment? So just again, we need to write a Hadoop space fs command, hyphen, the same Unix command, make directory, forward slash user, forward slash training, and then let's say I want to make what, Hadoop underscore 0314. Okay, so has been this directory been created or not? How to go ahead and look it? So Hadoop with fs hyphen, see the content of our slash user slash training. So see, this particular file is created, or this directory is created here. So if you have knowledge on Unix commands, so the same command, set of commands are used here in Hadoop. If you are playing around with data in Hadoop environment, it's just that we need to prefix this particular keyword, Hadoop space fs and then a hyphen, and then any other command can take care. So this is how you toggle between Hadoop environment and your local environment in Hadoop setup, and that is what generally is required. Suppose you have a, in your actual projects, you'll have a landing zone where your source file would be landing. So from your landing zone, you need to bring in those files into HDFS environment. So there should be some way by which you should be able to bring your file into HDFS environment. So in that case, these things come in handy, toggling between the local environment and the Hadoop environment. So now, as I was saying that, suppose I want to bring up a file. So as I said, like the requirement is to bring a file from a local setup to a Hadoop setup. So how do we go about it, bringing files onto a Hadoop environment or a Hadoop setup, HDFS? Okay, so this is how it happened. Now, since we need to bring in a file into a Hadoop environment, this is the command we'll be using. Hadoop fs hyphen put, this is the put command which will put your file from where. So okay, before that I need to see where am I am into home training, and do I have that, which file do I need to load? Assume that I want orders.txt from this path, okay, or any file. Any file, I'll take it from here. and dump it into this particular path, user training, user force plus user force plus training in HDFS environment. Okay, so I'll be taking orders.txt. So how do we do that? The command to bring your files from your local environment to a Hadoop environment is Hadoop fs hyphen put command will load your data into HDFS environment. What was it? Orders.txt to forward slash where, so this is the source file name and now this is the target directory where we want the files to be present. So forward slash user train. So this is the file and this is the place where I want this particular file to be displayed. Okay, so this command came in. Now let's have a look into the user training folder whether this file has come in there or not. So what is the command? Hadoop space fs hyphen ls user training. So if you see, this orders.txt file has been loaded into this Hadoop environment today. Okay, so this is how you load files into a Hadoop environment and from here you can work. So now since we have our files in Hadoop environment, now we can write different MapReduce programs or any other applications like using Bigdata or HBase or other tools to mine upon our data and to do further analysis. So the first step is to bring our files into the Hadoop platform. Once you have the files present, then you can go ahead and manipulate them. Now, you are talking about tables. So if you want to bring tables onto a Hadoop environment, we have separate set of clients like Scoop, which will fetch in data from different sources and bring it onto a table. So there are different clients to do that, but as of now, we are just talking about how, or like this getting acquainted with the HDFS environment, and then once you have files available in the HDFS environment, how do we go ahead and work on it? So this is about how we bring files onto a HDFS environment and how do we manipulate, what are the different features available for manipulation, that we'll be discussing probably in the next class. So the thing is that this class I had to take it on a short notice, so I'd like to wrap it up today. If you have any questions, then I'll take it up, or else I'll wrap it because I have to take this on a very short notice and I have prior appointments at around 11. So I'll be wrapping this up. If you have any questions, you can certainly go ahead and ask.
No, nothing much in this. I think we'll learn more tomorrow, right? Then basically, right?
Yeah, I'll confirm with the organizers on next class. So like this particular commands and all were you taught earlier or like, because I'm not sure what
no, no. I haven't been to its environment yet, right? So we haven't done anything about commands. Yeah, but yeah, that's fine. So we need to go from this one. So I need to now understand like basically how to write the MapReduce program, right? And then how to submit in the Hadoop environment and then see how specifically the whole thing. So we need to go through the whole process.
Yeah, the whole process, like how to write big programs, a high program, map reduce program, all these things need to be.
So how to submit it. And also, so basically, I know we'll be working in a single machine, right? But I want to see how we can submit a job in, you know, different the node that is main nodes and, you know, possible. A similar environment, right? I think we can have multiple virtual machines and put them right on different name nodes and all, right? Different the data nodes and also maybe try if we can replicate that bit of that, you know. So just to understand of the whole how Hadoop works, you know, how we can do data programming that,
We have Cloudera. In this Cloudera setup, we have something called as Cloudera Manager, which tells us about the details about name node, data node, and all. That we'll see once we see.
So you use this Cloudera environment, right? So I think I have Cloudera. Let me just check once so that I can do a bit of my work when you are away.
Okay.
I think I have Cloudera training VM 1.6. So that's it.
So, yeah, that's fine.
Not an issue. Yeah. So maybe I can do bit of go through this environment, just run some commands and all, right? So
you can just get acquainted with this stuff.
Yeah, and then get acquainted, you know. I tried writing a bit of a small map with this program using, I have the book from Tom White or someone, right? I tried writing a bit of a program through that, but I was not able to do anything because so maybe we can go through that basically.
Definitely.
So what I want to do is like basically have a file, right? Write the whole MapReduce program, run it the whole process and see how the output comes out how we can use it quickly. So we
definitely. So the first step is to bring in the files into HDFS and then we'll go into how to process the files using MapReduce.
Now, if you get it from this environment to local one, you use the get command from there, right?
Yes. Okay. So there's a put and then the corresponding get command.
If you want to copy within the Hadoop environment, it'll be copy command, basically, right? So.
Yes.
Okay. So it's same thing.
It's just the same Unix command. Just we are fixing with this Hadoop. That's it.
Okay. I use the Hadoop FS, but I didn't know why we are using this. So now I understand this. Yeah, why we are using this command. Okay.
Yeah, so, just to get into the Hadoop, it just tells the terminal that run this particular command on a Hadoop environment, not on the local environment. That's
okay. That's it. If possible, will you be able to send me your PowerPoint presentation? What I can do is I can go through that a bit, right? And if I have questions, we can ask, we can discuss also, and so that way, it'd be quicker communication between us. Yeah.
I will send you across the hand notes. There are a few slides which are a bit confidential, but whatever document materials I can send across to these.
You can send. Maybe you can hit the organizer, or if you want, I can give my email ID. You can just email me. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, send across to the organizers. They will forward it.
Okay, so that's fine. Okay, thanks. I was planning this actually. I was planning this to happen in every weekend, basically for last couple of weeks, and I wanted to finish this training as soon as possible. I don't want to delay it too long. Yeah, because there's a small project coming up in our company, and I want to get involved in that. So, with the knowledge of Hadoop environment will help in that. Yeah. So I'm only delayed by almost 2 weeks. This training was supposed to start almost 2-3 weeks back. Then we had 1 day training and then we had to cancel, rest of them. So if possible, I'll appreciate, if you can have something tomorrow also. I'm fine to do in the morning my time or evening, So
definitely I'll see to it. But the thing is that I just got onto this, very short notice.
Yeah.
So I'll see based upon my
Tell me your time. Tomorrow, I'm okay at this time, right? This 4:30 p.m. I'm okay to work. I'm okay to start a bit late also if you want to. By 4 o'clock I'm okay to start tomorrow. Yeah. So just confirm.
Okay. I'll confirm. Sure.
All right. Okay. Thank you.
No. Thanks, Suresh. Bye.